All right, well, welcome back and welcome to some new faces that are here. I do want to talk a little bit about today in this session. I'm going to do another quick little warm-up because I know we've got a couple new people and we've had a break, so we need to warm up. And I'm going to do an overview of item creation, so different types of questions that you can use. And I'm going to kind of overview that. I'm going to talk about item analysis, overview of some different kinds of reports that we have. I'm not going to go through all of them because we have 32 different reports that you could use with our system. Trust me, I'm not going to take you through all 32, but I'm just going to give you a quick overview, and then I'm going to talk really quickly about session management, and then we'll wrap up as far as that goes. So that's today's session 2 agenda. So here we're going to warm up. All right, I would like to know whether you are an herbivore, a carnivore, an omnivore, or you're not really sure. All right, and I think, all right, perfect. So I think the lucky number 13 we're at again here. So let's see what we are made up of here. All right, so we've got, wow, actually equally omnivores and equally carnivores. So we've got absolutely no herbivores in here, and some people just aren't sure at all. Okay, very good. True or false, the official state dance of the state of Illinois is the polka. Is that true or false? All right, 13 of us are in. So 62% said false. That is the correct answer. It is false. The actual official dance is the square dance. I don't know if anybody knew that. And now I see some nodding of the heads like, oh, that's right. Don't you hate that? Okay. All right, so that's our quick warm-up for the second session here. So I want to talk a little bit about some careful slide creation because it's obviously very important. And it's no real different than if you're using traditional PowerPoint. But then I'm going to go off into different kinds of questions that you can ask as well. So I would like you to see if you can count how many things are wrong with this particular slide. Some of you are really trying to count. I'll give you a hint. There's really no right answer here. So I'm going to go right ahead. So you're like, I want to get it right. Isn't it funny? Because you really want to get it right, right? So that's part of how this whole system works. You want to work really hard to do that. So I'm going to close polling. Some of you said 4. Most of you said more than 4 at least. And some people said you can't count that high. The whole issue is you want to make sure that your fonts stay the same size and you don't have this kind of thing going on. You want to make sure that you're using readable fonts, that any kind of visuals that you're using are obviously good visuals, that your colors that you're using show up. Oftentimes in a classroom, before the first day of class, I go in and I make 2 slides. I make a dark slide with light print, and then I make a light slide with dark print, and I go in and make sure that which one's going to show, because different classrooms are different, and I make sure which one's going to work better for this semester in this classroom, and so I go through that. The other thing, and I will kind of point this out, particularly when we get to the multiple choice section, and talking about that, is that typically if you're going to use answer numbers, and I don't know if any of you all teach kind of quantitative type courses where you might have answer choices, that you typically don't want to use number choices for number answer choices because it can get a little confusing for the students, and they're like, oh, well, I thought this was different, and it just is. So you can use the ABC, and you can actually set that up in our system, whatever you want to use, if you want to use Roman numerals or however, so whatever it is that you, however you want to set that up. On average, the attention span of a college level learner is it 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, or 30 minutes? What attention span? Should that be an answer? All right, everybody's in. Let's see what you guys thought. So 46% said 5 minutes. And some of you actually thought 30 minutes. The actual real answer is 20 minutes. So rule of thumb generally is that about every 20 minutes, if you aren't using the clickers all that often, that insert a slide or two, a question slide using clickers every 20 minutes or so, because it gets the students back engaged again. And I mean, we've all seen them kind of just this. So if you can get them engaged using the clickers about every 20 minutes at least. So if you have an hour class, bringing them out a few times is a great thing to do. When you're developing the types of questions that you're going to have for your clicker questions, you need to consider the average response time. Because obviously if you are now going to be by teaching by questioning rather than teaching by lecturing, then it's going to take more time. So you need to consider what is the average response time per the type of question that you might be asking. So a true-false question, they say on average about 30 seconds, multiple choice and multiple answer about 60 to 90 seconds, and matching and ordering about 30 seconds per response. Now this is paper. These are responses per paper. I have found that actually using the clickers, it's not quite as long as this, but it certainly is something worth taking into consideration. So if you're going to be asking 15 multiple choice questions, you have to kind of consider how much time of the class might that take up. One of the things that I often get asked is, well, am I going to have to throw out something that I might normally lecture on because I'm using time to ask questions? And the answer traditionally is probably. Something's going to have to give. But my answer then to follow that is, well, but what I am teaching, wouldn't I want the students to learn that a little bit deeper? And if I can do that using this system, using these techniques, and getting them to actually really engage in the material that I am teaching, that's better for me anyway, and I think it's better for them. So if I have to throw out one small topic in a class period, I can typically do that, and I don't see any problem with that, because what I have taught, they actually have learned. So some general item creation practices. I'm going to kind of go through this pretty quickly. Obviously, we all know what a multiple choice question is. I like this cartoon, Choose B Every Time. I actually had a student one time say to me, you know, I didn't, and on a real test, I don't use the clickers for high stakes exams. I just don't do that for a number of reasons. One, that the timing. Questions, students answer questions at a different rate, so I want everybody to be able to answer at their own rate. But I have students, I actually don't use Scantrons, I have them write the answers out if it's a multiple choice question test. And one student said to me that all the answers on one page were B, and he said, I just started thinking, you would never do that. So I went and back and changed my answers, and I'm like, I don't formulate the test on how that works that way, particularly on a handwritten test. So. Don't think don't let that fool you. So multiple choice questions, just some quick do's and don'ts when you're making some multiple choice questions. You want to make sure that you leave questions, if you can, at the end of the stem. So the question part of the question, you want to make sure that you're trying to leave the blank at the end there, as opposed to starting the question out with blank is, and starting that way. Use reasonable or plausible distractors, and I'm going to talk about a whole slide of that as well, because that's a really important part of forming a multiple choice question, and I'm also going to talk then about that when we mention about item analysis as well. Give 3 to 5 answer choices, typical. Use letters in front of numbers choices. I just mentioned that a few minutes ago. And keep your option links similar. It's very common for us to have the right answer be the longest answer, and then all the shorter answers that we come up with are kind of shorter, and it gives the students a clue as to what is the right answer. So try to make them all similar, and then balance the placement of the correct answer if you can. So typical answer choices are always B and C, and so try to throw in an A and D as if you can in there, because students will always kind of go to B and C. And as instructors, we typically say, well, I'll formulate them, and the answer is always either B or C. So try to balance those out. The don'ts, don't use ambiguous wording. Obviously, the students will catch you on that one, and it's not good for the question anyway. Don't use overlapping choices, And so if you, particularly when you're talking about maybe stages of development, maybe in child development, you want to make sure that you're not saying 3 to 5, 5 to 8, because that can be confusing as well. Don't give clues to the correct answer by making it longer or so forth. Don't use negatives. I've often found sometimes we'll put in double negatives, and that confuses the students. And I just was recently on jury duty, and I was being chosen or possibly chosen for jury duty, and the lawyer asked me a question in voir dire about how I felt about something, and it was a double negative question. And I just sat there and I looked at her and I said, "I'm sorry, I'm trying to follow with the question you just asked me, but it's a double negative and I don't know how I'm supposed to answer this. I want to answer honestly. So if you could rephrase it, then I'll be able to answer the question." So it kind of gave me, I was sitting there kind of in the student mode going, well, I want to answer this the way I need to, but the double negative made that difficult. And be careful about using the none of the above option. I know it's really common. I do use it. I'm not saying don't ever use it, but be really careful, because if that is actually the answer, you really don't know if the students know the answer. So be careful about overusing that one. Meaningful distractors, just a couple quick rules. Make sure that they're plausible. In other words, they're not just, let me give you an example. When I talk about the Boston Consulting Group matrix, we have 4 different elements in the Boston Consulting Group matrix. We have stars, cash cows, dogs, and question marks. Now, the students all know those 4. Now, if I ask them a question on an exam, something about the Boston Consulting Group, and I said, stars, dogs, cats, they're going to be like, well, obviously it's cats. That's not one of the 4 quadrants. So make sure that they're obviously plausible answers. Incorporate common errors, and I'm going to show you an example of that in a second, and then use true statements that don't correctly answer the question.